much for coming to the Bottom Lake Public Library to tonight to spend an evening with our very special guests, Dr. Darold Treffert and Jason Padgett. So this is the first event in our series in conjunction with our 2016 Fond du Lac Reads book, Struck by Genius, How a Brain Injury May Be a Mathematical Marvel. So please check out the library's website and the handouts you have for all the other events that we're going to do in conjunction with the book this basically through the entire month of October. I want to point out right away that tonight's event would not have happened without the generous support of the Treffert Center of Magnesian Healthcare. This amazing center, located right here in Fond du Lac, seeks to preserve, make available, and expand the legacy of Dr. Treffert with his work in the areas of autism, Savant syndrome, and related conditions. So I ask you to put your hands together and thank the Treffert Center of Magnesian Healthcare for their generosity. So in 2002, Jason Padgett was just an average guy, not the best student. He had graduated from high school just a little while back. He got by selling futons and spending his time pumping iron and partying. But a brutal attack changed all that. Muggers jumped him outside a bar and left him on the sidewalk, a victim of severe head trauma. He woke up a different man. Suddenly he saw the world as a complex system of mathematical structures. His very rare case of acquired savant syndrome is explored in his book, Struck by Genius. And tonight, Dr. Treffert and Jason will talk about Jason's injury and his amazing road to recovery. So it gives me great pleasure to introduce to you once again, Jason Padgett and Dr. Darold Treffert.
Hi, thank you everybody for coming. Normally I try to have some drawings to show, but I wasn't able to have them with me today. Some of them I can probably show you up here on these screens.
Oops.
We lost it.
I will get them right back up.
Okay, perfect. Actually, this is great then. So I can start out with just a little bit of history of what my life was like before. A lot of times I describe my life as two separate lives. I was born in Alaska, had a pretty much, you know, typical upbringing, and then as I got older, I was kind of like a typical silly guy that never really grew up. I spent literally every single day chasing girls, going out to bars with my friends. We would go out till 3 o'clock in the morning, goof off, come home, wake up the next day with an incredible hangover. And then as soon as that hangover was gone by 6 p.m., the next thing I knew, we were out the next night and going out to the bars. And that's really what life consisted of when I was younger. We weren't mean or anything, but it was definitely a very shallow life. And I would constantly use phrases like math is stupid, or how does math apply to anything in the real world? And I didn't know it existed in a way that was really useful. And then in 2002, my friend Angela, she was at a little karaoke bar, and she called me up, and she was on a first date with this guy, and they had had too much to drink, and they wanted a ride home. So I drove to this little karaoke bar to pick them up, and when I got there, I wound up having a Coke and singing a song. And as I was up there singing, there was these two guys in the bar that had also been singing karaoke, and they didn't look like they were rough-looking guys or anything. They looked clean-cut and nice. And so I wound up singing a song, and as we left, these two guys left behind us. And as we walked out of the bar, the two guys attacked me from behind. I didn't see it coming at all. I felt, and more than even felt, I heard this deep thud as the first guy smashed me in the back of the head. The people who saw it said, you know, they came running up behind me. The first one hit me in the back of the head. And I saw something that it was a puff of like white light, just like somebody took a picture. In fact, boxers a lot of time describe it as a flash knockdown. You see this flash as you get knocked out. And it's literally like that. I saw a flash of light, and the next thing I knew, I was on my knees, and I didn't know who I was, where I was, why I was, where I was, and why I was getting kicked and hit in the face from all these different directions. It was very strange. I don't know how many people have been knocked out, but getting knocked out, even for that moment, when you come to, you really don't understand or know anything. And then I remember realizing that I was being attacked, and I thought I was being attacked by a whole gang of people. I thought there was like 10 people all beating on me, and I didn't realize for a moment that it was just two guys. And then when I realized that I was being attacked, I had this feeling of impending doom, like I'm going to die right now for certain. This is the end. And that fight or flight instinct came on. And I was still down literally on the ground, so I had no chance to flee. So it was the fight instinct that came on. And strangely enough, the only thing I remember thinking is, I want to hurt one of these guys before I die. You know, which is very strange, but that's literally what I thought. And I remember grabbing one of the guy's legs, because it also helped balance me, because I was so dizzy still. And I tried to bite him on the inside of the leg, but he had those big baggy pants on. And so all I got was fabric, and I bit down so hard I broke my front teeth. So I wound up hurting myself trying to damage him. And then the other guy, as I was still trying to you know, do any damage that I could to this guy, he started kicking me in the back of the head. And one of the blows hit me in my kidney. And for some reason, that was the one that took, you know, the fight out of me. And finally, one of them said, "Give me your goddamn jacket." And I was wearing a little, you know, $99 Wilson's leather jacket, which at that point was already torn up. And I threw the jacket off, and they rolled away from the one guy, and they grabbed my jacket, and they took off. And until that point, they hadn't said one word. And so I wound up getting taken to the hospital, which luckily was like maybe 200 feet away across the street. And they diagnosed me with a concussion and a bleeding kidney, and they gave me some really strong pain medicine and sent me home. They sent me home. And I remember thinking how strange everything looked, but I was on this really strong pain medicine, so to this day I'm still not sure what I was seeing that first night, whether it was the pain medicine or whether things had already been, you know, truly altered. On a side note, before I get into what happened, we did wind up catching the guys. After I got attacked, I went back there later, and when I realized that the guys were singing karaoke, they wrote their names on the karaoke slips, and they sang their songs, and then they turned that into sing. So I was like, we had their names on the karaoke slips, and we have their fingerprints. And when I told the restaurant this, the owner of the restaurant said, "Too bad, leave, we're not going to help you." And I was so stunned that they wouldn't help that I thought, for some reason, they're protecting these guys. You know, it seemed like that to me. So we went to labor ready, and we hired 15 guys and had them ring the restaurant with signs that says, "Violent crime happens here, ask us about it." And as soon as we did that, the business, you know, dropped at that place. Nobody would go eat there. But it only lasted an hour, and then the owner came out and said, "If I will give you their names, will you leave?" And I said, "Sure." And he gave me their first names, last names, home, phone numbers, everything. And it turned out the two guys were dating the two girls that worked there, the bartender and the waitress. And when you paid your bill, the girls would see who had cash, point you out to the boyfriends, and you get mugged. And there had been several muggings there with the exact same MO over the previous 4 months. So we showed up at their house with the police, and they got arrested. But after that, the next day, after this attack happened, when I woke up, it was clear that it wasn't the pain medicine. Everything before my injury, when something would move, like for instance my hand moving, it looks like it's moving smoothly. After this happened, when anything moves, it looks like individual picture frames. Like imagine you're watching television, like an old VCR or on your DVR, and you know how you can continually hit pause and you can see frame by individual frame? It's just like that, only in real time. And everything that's used to be a smooth curve looks like it's slightly pixelated, like it has little straight edges. And so basically the smoothness to reality was gone, and this smoothness of motion was gone. And I was amazed to realize that our brain constructs a moving image much like a video camera with individual pictures. So a lot of you have probably seen those little flip books where you draw a picture on several pages and you flip it and you see the character move, but it moves jittery. Well, we see those picture frames, but our brain smooths it out for you, so you're not, my hand doesn't look like this. But now that smoothness for me is gone. And what that does for you mathematically is absolutely astounding, because we're all doing math, we just don't realize it. But I won't get there quite yet. So basically, after this happened, I developed some other conditions that I didn't have before. I used to be able to drop food on the floor, and I could have the 5-second rule, no problem. I could pick it up and eat it. After this happened, I was obsessed with germs. I would be walking along the road, and I would find myself at like 243, and I realized I'm counting my steps, or I'm counting how many trees I'm walking by, or I'm counting how many flowers have a prime number of petals, which aren't very many, by the way. Most of them are nice and symmetrical. And I was also obsessed with germs. I found myself like setting my alarm clock repeatedly. I would set my alarm clock and say, well, what if I forgot that I set it? So then I would check it again and say, well, what if I thought I, you know, forgot to set it? What if that was yesterday? And I would do things repeatedly over and over again. Even though I knew it was silly, I still felt this weird compulsion to do it, which turned out to be obsessive compulsive disorder. But at the time, I didn't know what that was. It got so bad at one point, I was literally Lysoling every single piece of money that I had until it was soaking wet with Lysol. And then I would let it dry, and then I would put it in the microwave for 30 seconds on high to make sure that I was killing all the germs. And what made it even worse is I stopped getting sick. So since I stopped catching colds or the flu, it kind of reinforced it, and it made it even worse. Plus, since when I got attacked, the restaurant was full of people, and they all watched. Nobody called 911, you know, nobody helped. And so I went through this post-traumatic stress of where I didn't want to be in public. I didn't want to be around. Any time I was, I wanted to have the wall at my back or be in a corner so I could see whoever it was that was facing me. And I wound up holing up in my house for like 3.5 years because I was trying to deal with this change in perception of reality. And also this severe, for me, what was severe, you know, traumatic stress. Because basically my faith at that point in everybody, you know, in your safety in the world was shattered. And so for 3.5 years, I kind of call it this introspective period where I was learning to deal with the change in the way everything looked. I also went through a severe bout of vertigo where it looked like things were moving, but it also felt like things were moving. So I remember trying to get out of bed and my leg going sideways instead of going down because it just felt like that was down instead of this. And so it took a while to adjust. But the beauty of seeing things in picture frames is absolutely stunning because there are patterns that are there that you just don't see when you see things smoothly. Like if a bird is flapping its wings and it stops flapping, it stops and makes this nice upside down parabolic arc for a moment. Or if it's flying up and then it stops, it comes down and makes their specific, which I now know are called families of equations, you know, that you can graph equations into shapes. But you see these same patterns repeatedly everywhere. And for instance, if something is moving fast, the picture frames are further apart, and if something's moving slower, the picture frames are closer together. So imagine like there's a car, and it's moving 60 miles an hour, and your brain's taking a picture every second. Then from here, from 1 second to 2 seconds, say the car moves this far. But in the next 1 second interval, just imagine that car, instead of going 60 miles an hour, it goes 120 miles an hour. Then the next picture frame is twice as long as this picture frame. And if you take those two picture frames and you subtract them from each other, you can tell something's velocity and you can tell its acceleration just by looking at the size of the picture frames. And so I eventually started feeling this compulsion to draw what I was seeing. And so the first thing I started to draw was the number pi. And what was so strange is that some of it was just there. Like, I remember seeing the double rainbow and instantly recognizing the double rainbow as the number pi, the geometry of the number pi. But I didn't even know how to calculate the area of a circle, pi r squared, at the time. But I knew that that was pi. And I knew that velocity and acceleration were subtracting these frames. And it was very strange to see that some of these things were just there. And as I started analyzing it, you start to find patterns where you actually are starting to learn from it. But so some of it seems as though it's already there, but then once you learn how to view things differently, you do learn a lot from it. So So as I started to try to draw it, the first thing I drew was the number pi. And pi is 3.1415926.5. It's the ratio of a circle's circumference divided by its diameter. So to say, for instance, the circle is 6.28 around, and the diameter is how far a line is through the center of the circle to the other side. So say the diameter is 2, then 6.28 divided by 2 is 3.14. And so pi is doing its best to describe a circle. And so as I drew it, I don't know if I have any drawings here with me to show you.
Let's see.
So this one here, this is what the number pi looks like at a certain value. This one took weeks and weeks and weeks to draw, because they're all hand-drawn, they're just drawn with a pencil. But basically, what pi shows and what the numbers in pi are showing is it's trying to describe a circle, but what pi actually proves is that there is no such thing as a circle. Anytime you think you're looking at a circle, or any time you think you're looking at a curve, they actually don't exist. They're an illusion created from relativity. So the best way to think about it, since I don't have multiple drawings to show you, I'm going to explain it in a slightly different way. But the best way to think about how circles don't exist, circles are actually made from triangles, is to imagine you're looking at a television screen. You know how every time if you look at a computer or a television, you see like a circle or the letter O on a computer? It looks like it's a circle. But TV screens and computers are made with square pixels. And you can't take squares and make a circle with squares. So if you look at the edge of the circle, it's just a little zigzag where the pixels, are there. So you're not really seeing a curve. Now imagine you take the pixels and you cut them in half. And then you cut them in half again, and you cut them in half again. So you're basically taking a square and making a new square, a smaller one, and a smaller square, and a smaller square. You can keep cutting those pixels in half to infinity. And so the edge of the circle gets smoother and smoother and smoother as the pixels get smaller and smaller and smaller. But you never can reach a perfect circle, because to have a flawless circle, you technically have to have an infinite number of sides. So what pi's digits are describing as they go out forever is they are describing the pixels getting tinier and tinier and filling in a little bit more space as you forever approach a circle, but you never actually reach it. Another good way to think about it is like for instance, I look like I'm curved, like my arm's curved, but I'm made with little rectangle cells. So, I'm just so big compared to the cells that it looks like a curve. Or, for instance, you look at a mountain. If you look at a big, tall mountain, it doesn't look like it's a circle, but you zoom out into outer space and you look at the Earth, and the Earth looks like it's a sphere because you're so far away. So basically, your size and how far away you are relative to what you're looking at makes it look like a circle, but technically there is no such thing as a circle. And the implications of it are absolutely amazing. When it comes down to understanding math, and the universe, literally, understanding technically how a circle works geometrically can literally teach you calculus. So once you understand, the concept of a circle, you understand integral, at least the concept of integral calculus, and the way that the edge of a circle works, those pixels getting tinier and tinier, that is something called differential calculus, which is a secant line approaching a tangent line problem. So we can basically understand these difficult concepts with a simple drawing. And so as I started trying to draw these things, I drew them out finer and finer, but at that point I had no traditional math training. In fact, when I went to high school, this is a true story, it's really embarrassing, but when I was in my second senior year, it was my second senior year because I had skipped like 60 or 70 days the previous senior year, and I immediately had lost credit for the year. In my second senior year, I took the exact amount of credits needed to graduate. And so long as I actually passed my classes, I would graduate. And I was in a mythology class, and every other class I had friends that would let me copy their homework every day. So I had made it through school literally without doing any work. And I was in this mythology class with my friend Larry, and we had a collage that we had to do, and it was due the last day of school. And it was, the teacher said, you cannot pass the class without turning in this collage. It was worth, you know, a very large percent of our score. And so the whole, and she warned us over and over again, you got to turn this in collage or you can't pass the class. And for me, if I didn't pass that class, I didn't graduate again. And the very last day of school came, and the teacher says, all right, everybody, turn in your collages. And I realized, my goodness, I haven't even started my collage. And I'm like, I'm going to do a third senior year. And my friend Larry came up to me and he said, Jason, do I know you better than anybody? And I said, yeah, why? And he goes, because I knew you wouldn't do your collage and I knew you wouldn't graduate, so I did too. And he had a second collage completely done, and it was about baseball, which was his passion. And I got an A minus on my collage that he did for me, and he got a B plus on the one that he did for me. So literally to this day, he's the reason why I was able to graduate from high school. So yeah, we still talk about that now, the fact that he got the lower score. But so anyway, as this is going on and I'm living in my house, I had completely holed up in my house. I had blankets over all the windows in my house, blocking out the outside world. I had my front door literally glued shut with spray foam. I put spray foam that turned like into glue so the front door wouldn't open. You could only get out through the back, and I only left to get food or if I had to pick up my daughter was coming over. And that went on for like 3.5 years while I, you know, learned and experimented by drawing the way that I saw things working. And then one day, I ran out of food, and I absolutely had to leave the house. And I went to the mall, and I had a Subway sandwich, and I brought some drawings with me. Because at the time, I didn't know that, like, pi had been discovered by anybody else. So when I discovered pi, and I discovered integrals and derivatives, I thought I was the one who discovered it. So everywhere, you know, I kept those drawings with me because I didn't want to lose them and I didn't want anybody else to find them. And so I'm at the mall and I'm drawing, and a guy next to me starts talking to me, and it turned out he was a physicist, and he was asking me what classes I was taking because I started trying to explain pi to him. And he says, well, these look really mathematical, but I've never heard anybody draw it and explain it. He said, you're talking about, you know, space-time and light and things like that, but you're doing it in this way that it's all layman terms. I've never heard it, you know, explained like this. And he said, why don't you see if you can go back to school, take some traditional math classes, and maybe we can learn to speak the same language, and maybe you can prove what you're talking about. And that's what I did. It was that one thing that kind of kicked me and got me moving out of the house. So I went and I enrolled at Tacoma Community College, and I enrolled in Math 99, which is just algebra, and that was the day that I learned that you can graph an equation on a grid. I didn't even know that you could graph a linear equation, a little straight line on a graph at that time. And I was hooked because I told the teacher, I said, you mean every equation with your guys' numbers and x squared, et cetera, you mean those can all be graphed into a shape? And she said, yes. And I said, we are talking about the same thing. I am just seeing the shapes, and you're seeing the numbers that make the shapes. But for me, the shapes are the natural forms of numbers. You know, we use numbers just to describe the geometry of the universe, which is the natural form of numbers. And so I was hooked from day one, and eventually was able to write the equations to show that what I was drawing was the number pi. But what surprised me, I remember taking, again, go back to how I thought I discovered this. I remember calling, like, University of Washington's math department and saying, hey, you guys have got to hear about this. You know, there's this, a circle doesn't actually exist, and there's an infinite number of sides. And the guy was like, well, that's very great, but, you know, Archimedes discovered that 2,000 years ago. Wow, I feel like the professor from Gilligan's Island, you know, he's like inventing things that have already been around for 20 years. And then I showed him integrals, and he said, that's nice too, but, you know, Newton did that in the 1600s. But then he said, but you're in good company at least, and the fact that you came to it yourself without any math training is a... at least it shows us that there's a different way to teach this. Because if you take somebody like me who thought math was dumb and belittled it and make me like so excited, I'm like vibrating to just tell people, do you know this? Then you can make anybody excited about it if you teach it the right way. Because even when I went back to school, I found that the way that they teach equations was pretty boring, you know. It's dry, and a lot of times they wouldn't show, or you wouldn't see the meaning behind it. At least a lot of the students didn't. But since I already knew the concept of integrals and how pi worked, and a lot of different things mathematically, but in a geometric sense, as I was going through the classes, I was learning something different and on a much deeper level than many of the students that I was with. And I found it surprising, as well as many of the professors did, that like I would show them the number pi, and I thought I was going to hold the shape up, and they were going to say, that's the number pi, and let us explain to you the equation. And I would show them the shape, and they would say, what are you showing me? And I would be like, this is the number pi. How can you know equations and not know that this is pi? And they would say, how can you draw pi and not know the equations? You know, but really, they are the exact same thing. It's just two different languages to describe it. And so going through this process was actually one of the best things I ever did. I didn't take any of the other courses, though. I didn't take English. I didn't take, you know, anything but math and physics, because I just wanted to be able to learn this, and that was it. I didn't care about a degree. And when I went back to school, that was when I started also learning how to deal with the OCD that came with this. Like OCD, it's always there, and it's like this compulsion to constantly clean your hands and to do these silly things. And even though you know it's silly, you keep doing it. And I remember being at school one day and being stuck outside the math lab because I couldn't walk in the math lab because the button that you pressed, that I always pressed with my elbow, that would make the door open automatically, was broken. And so I couldn't touch the doorknob to get into the math lab. And I remember standing there for about 5 minutes, and finally this one teacher that knew me saw me standing there, and she understood and came over and said, would you like me to open the door so you can get in? And I said, yes. And that was kind of the time that I realized that there had to be some way to try to treat it, because there's a lot of people that have different forms of OCD at different levels, and there is a treatment for it, which I went through, which is called desensitization therapy. Basically, I'd go into the doctor, and you'd look at a doorknob, which to me is just the worst thing in the world, you know, and they would clean it with the bleach wipe, so you know it's clean, and then you would touch it, and then, like, touch your face, and you would progressively touch things that you felt were dirtier and dirtier until you got desensitized to it. And and strangely enough, it did work, and it worked pretty quickly. Within a week, you know, or even 2 weeks, it changes to where you can get out into public and you can start dealing with reality, you know, in a way that you couldn't before. At least it makes you functional, you know, whereas before I couldn't leave the house, at least then I could get out and do things. And so at the same time, when I went back to school, I wound up I met a girl while I was at school, and who eventually wound up getting married. So, you know, we just had a 2-year-old daughter. We've got a 19-year-old daughter and 2-year-old daughter, and a 2-month-old daughter. So I never thought I'd have 3 kids 20 years apart, almost. But anyway, if this horrible event hadn't happened, which for the first 3.5 years seemed like the worst thing ever to me, in the long run, it turned out to be the best thing ever, because I literally wouldn't have my kids if it wasn't for this attack. and so in the long run, it did turn out to be an absolutely wonderful thing. And now I wouldn't give it up for anything, because there are things that I never thought I could understand that I can now, just because of seeing things differently and realizing some of the knowledge that we all have in us. Like, for instance, when you're looking at my hand, and now I'm moving this fast, but now my hand just sped up. The reason why you can tell that my hand sped up is because for that first little interval of time, it moved this distance. But for the next interval, it moved farther in the same amount of time. So every one of you, just by seeing that my hand sped up, you just did calculus, literally for real. You just did it in a geometric sense, and you're all programmed to do it. But if we were to sit down and crunch that in class, that's a good solid equation that would take, you know, 6 semesters or 6 quarters of nothing but math school to be able to define, yet every single one of us just watched me do it, and animals can do it too. So we're all crunching math, and we're doing it constantly. We're just doing it in this natural way. So when you see things like this, you can understand, all of us can understand things like relative perspective. For instance, like if we all were to look at my, just say for instance, my shirt is blue, you know, slightly gray, but just say it's blue. I could technically and be correct by saying my shirt is not this color. My shirt is every single color in existence. My shirt is purple, it is red, it is green, literally. And if I were to sing a note right now, I'm literally singing every single note in existence. And even though it sounds weird right now, you'll understand it in just a second. So you've all heard a car drive by you, and you know how when a car drives by, it goes, and it changes pitch. The reason why it changes pitch is because when sound waves, a short wavelength that is close together like this, we hear that as a high pitch. And a long wavelength of sound, we hear that as a low pitch. So the car is coming towards you, and the sound wave is leaving the car. But since the car is moving towards you, that sound wave gets kind of squished together, even though not technically not exactly squished, but we're not going to get too technical. So just think of that sound wave as getting squished, which makes the wavelengths get closer together, and your brain hears that as a high pitch, and then the car goes, and now the pitch gets lower because the car is moving away from you, and those waves stretch out and get further apart. So your brain hears that as a low pitch. But now if we add relativity to it, and we imagine the car is coming from me towards you, well, as it's moving towards you, relative to me, it's moving away from me, so the wavelengths are stretching out and getting longer, so I hear the pitch to the car getting lower. But since it's moving towards you, you hear the pitch getting higher. And the person in the car, since they're traveling with the wave, they hear no pitch change, so they hear a medium pitch. Now what you do right there is you stop and you say, what sound is the car making? A low pitch? A high pitch or a medium pitch? And it's actually making all three sounds relative to who's looking at it. And then you say, which one of those realities is the real one? Even though all three of them are different, they're all real. And then the very last step is you say, now imagine there's an infinite number of people, and they're all looking at that same car, and everybody's moving at a different speed. Since they're all moving at a different speed, the waves stretch to a different wavelength, and every single person hears a different sound, and every single reality is real, it's just that they're relative. And that same concept applies to color. So for instance, you know, short wavelengths of light is a blue color, and long wavelengths of light are red. So if everybody in the audience, like if you all had twins, and your twins and I shot away from you guys right now at like, you know, high percentage of the speed of light, the wavelengths of light in my shirt would stretch out and get longer, and all of you would see my shirt change to red, literally. But your twins in motion with me, there would be no change in the wavelength, and they would see my shirt as blue or gray. And then you stop and say, well, what color is my shirt, red or blue? And technically, it is both relative to who's looking at it. And then the last step, of course, is saying that with an infinite number of people all looking at my shirt, and everybody's moving at a different velocity, every single person sees a different color. And even though every reality is different, every reality is real. And it's just the reality that you realize that becomes yours. The picture frames that you see is what you define as your reality. But somebody else moving at a different velocity relative to me would see a different reality. So every single moment literally has the potential to be anything. And every potential is an actual reality. It's just those realities that you don't realize aren't yours. Another good way to think of it is real and unrealized realities. You know, you realize my shirt is this color, somebody else moving at a different velocity relative to me will realize my shirt as whatever color is appropriate for their velocity relative to me. So these concepts you can also understand with just a drawing, whereas if we tried to crunch that as an equation, then you've got to go to school for, you know, 2 or 3 years, you know, high-level classes to be able to write that. But most of us, we don't need to write it as an equation. We just need to understand the idea. And your motion as you move doesn't just change light, colors. It doesn't just change sound. Everything changes. You know, you can change the taste of something, the smell of something. The faster you move, the slower time goes, literally. GPS satellites, you know, used to be off, you know, that had to tell us where we are. They used to be off by a little bit, and they weren't as accurate as they are now. And the reason why is because the faster you go, time actually slows down. And the satellites, which are up in orbit, they're doing like 30,000 miles an hour around the planet. So time is going slightly slower on the satellites than it is here on Earth, which makes the equation get off. And as soon as they realized that, somebody entered Einstein's time dilation equations into the GPS satellites, and that's the day that they all got accurate. So thinking about this way, it opens your mind to a much larger understanding of how the universe really works. I mean, who would really think that every one of us, you know, our shirt is every color? And so really your shirt is just a wave. It's a wave that is interpreted as color based on the position and the velocity of the observer who observes. So one of the things I like to think about is that old question that a lot of us have had, like if a tree falls in the forest and nobody's around to hear it, does it make a sound? It doesn't. It makes a wave, and only if something's there with hearing receptors does it actually make a sound. So, and then the sound that it makes is relative. So, at this point, we're kind of like, if anybody has any questions, I kind of like sometimes interacting.
I've always had the question, you know, if somebody speaks, or their native language was French, and now they learn English, and they speak English really good. I said, which way do you always think? Do you think in English, or do you think in French? But now, like you, when you see the equation, do you think in the drawing, or do you think in the numbers?
I think in drawing first. Like, when I started learning derivatives in calculus, I was envious, because there was a lot of these kids that they could just memorize the equations, and then they get an A on the test, but they didn't understand what it meant. I couldn't understand it unless I saw it and understood it geometrically first. Then I could go back and crunch the equation. So at first, when we were learning derivatives, I couldn't get it until I learned to think of it as light moving relative to light. Once I saw it that way, then it clicked, and then I understood how the equations work, but I also understood why. Because like one of the questions I always have is, how does the universe see numbers? Like, you know, the equation negative x squared makes an upside down parabola like this.
Right.
And I always think of, well, what's real? Is negative x squared actually real, or is it the parabolic shape that's real? And it's the shape that's real. Like anything you throw a ball in the air, it makes this upside down parabola. So I always think of pure geometry as being the natural form of numbers, because the universe is geometry. In fact, geometry is the one thing that everything has. Like, you know that question of what people say, this bottle is here because I put it there, and it's there because I walked in this room, and I walked in this room because I was there, and so there's a cause and there's an effect for everything, and you can keep going back in time forever. But if there was a beginning to time, then there had to be something that was first. But how could there be something that was first if nothing caused it? And that's this thing called the uncaused cause. If there was a beginning, there must be an uncaused cause. And what I think the uncaused cause is pure geometry. Nothing. Geometry is numbers, and geometry is the one thing. When I say geometry, I mean space. It's the one thing that everything has. You need absolutely nothing. Empty space is geometry. And everything that exists has geometry. So to me, geometry, it always exists. And what's so strange is that we have found that nothingness actually vibrates. Nothingness has energy from something called the uncertainty principle. So space-time itself vibrates from this thing called the uncertainty principle. And all the uncertainty principle is that you can't locate something's position and its velocity both perfectly. And the inability to measure perfectly is what actually makes space-time vibrate. And the way to think about it is, like, if I want to observe you, for instance, right? We hit you with photons and, you know, light, and then you emit photons back, and I see you. But when we hit you with the photons, even though they're very, you know, they're not super energetic, when they hit you, they move you just a little bit. Even if it's just one atom here or one atom to this direction, they still move you. And then it takes time for the light to get from you to me. So when the light gets to me, I know where you were, but now I don't know where you are, because by hitting you with the light, I moved you a little bit. So then we hit you with light again, and now I know where you were, but it takes time to get to me, but I don't know where you are. And this weird thing actually is what makes the universe run. Uncertainty is, it rules the universe, and it literally makes space vibrate. And it's one of the strangest things out there, but it's one of those things that's a fact, and it's real. And as it turns out, it's necessary. Of course, all of us, whenever you try to get down to the deepest part of it, nobody truly understands all of it completely. But just the mere fact that uncertainty exists allows everything to be. You know, if you could know something's position and velocity both perfectly, then there very likely would not be any motion.
Because you look at it in this different way, have you been able to help some of the smartest people in the world in these subjects? Have you been able to help them understand what they're doing?
I've been able to help, you know, people to see things from a different point of view. And I think where I'm going to have the most beneficial effect is helping kids. Because a lot of times adults, especially professors, they are able to learn, but they've been so structured for so long, it's really hard to think outside the box. And since I was completely untrained, I didn't know what the box was. You know, I didn't even know there was a box, so I did things in a very strange way, which turned out to be beneficial. But one of the things I want to do is I want to teach this to kids about like seventh grade. So I am always fixated on pi as the one big thing because it really does apply to everything. And when you understand how that works, when you take math classes, you're learning on a much deeper level, and you're also learning why things work the way they do. Like I noticed when we were graphing, like on a piece of graph paper, they would graph just a little linear equation where you put a dot here and a dot here and a dot here, and the kids were like, why do I want to put dots on a piece of graph paper? What does that mean? You know, that doesn't do anything for the real world. Well, space-time that we're all in, we're all moving through space-time right now, is a grid structure, a three-dimensional grid. And instead of graphing little dots on a piece of graph paper, think that we could graph an equation that makes the shape of my body. And so now, as I'm moving through space-time, you're graphing me as I move through space-time, and the equation that shows the shape that I am traveling through space-time can all be written down just like we do in algebra. So we are all literally able to be described with algebra and with calculus, and it's literally the same thing because we are immersed in this 3D grid of reality. It's just the grid of reality. Think of reality as having pixels, just like a TV. But the pixels, the tiniest that the pixels get in our universe is something called the Planck length. And the Planck length is very, very small. It's like a trillion, 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 billion times smaller than an electron. So it's super, super tiny, but there is an actual resolution to the universe, which is the Planck length. And where it comes from is really strange. The guy who discovered it, Maxwell Planck, won Nobel Prizes for discovering these minimum units of the universe, and they come from basically like the concept of black holes. One way to think about the Planck length is it comes from this problem called Zeno's paradox. Like if I want to travel from me to you, first I got to travel half the distance to you, and then I got to travel half that distance, and then I got to travel half that distance, and half that distance, and half that distance. If you're always traveling half the distance, then there's always half left over. So even if I'm a millimeter away, I travel half a millimeter, you never actually reach where you're trying to go. And that's this real math problem called Zeno's paradox. So if you can slice space infinitely small, you can never get anywhere. And so, but Planck's constants get around that. And the way it gets around it is, imagine, like, if we want to observe something, like I want to observe you, so we hit you with photons, and now I see you when photons are emitted back. But now imagine I want to observe like the skin cells on my finger, which are super tiny. So we focus a whole bunch of light to get into all those little tiny nooks and crannies, and I magnify it so we can see my skin cells. But in order to see something that small, we have to hit it with more energy because we're hitting it with more photons. So to observe things that are smaller, you have to hit it with more energy just to be able to observe it. And as we observe things smaller and smaller and smaller, you have to hit it with more and more and more energy just to be able to observe it. And you eventually reach the Planck length where if you want to observe something smaller than the Planck length, you have to hit it with so much energy that it causes that little point to collapse into a black hole, which then absorbs the photons and there's nothing left to observe. And it's wild, but that's where it comes from.
Yeah.
So, sounds like high school math, right?
Yeah, literally, yes. And what's so weird about it is that if you can't see something smaller than, like, say, we'll just say this is a Planck length. So say you can't see something smaller than this. That means you can't see something that's 1.5 Planck lengths because the half is smaller than one. So every single thing that you see in the universe is made from one, two, three, or whole multiples of the Planck lengths, but fractions don't exist. So what that does is it means now there's not an infinite number of slices between you and me. There's only so many of these Planck lengths. So the universe gets rid of infinity for us so that Zeno's paradox doesn't exist. So because space can't be cut infinitely tiny because of black holes.
You must have been fun at Burger King with all your buddies.
Oh, yeah, yeah. In fact, my family has made it a point to tell me we can't talk about black holes or relativity or light at the dinner table anymore or parallel
yes.
universes. So, in fact, I've had to practice shutting them. Yeah.
I don't know what a normal brain is, but have there been any, quote, studies comparing your brain to, quote, a normal brain?
Yeah, I had a functional MRI.
And if so, what are the differences in your brain? Maybe I'm getting into doctors.
Oh, yeah, no, there's been a lot. They had functional MRIs done. And a functional MRI can basically map thought or what part of the brain is controlling what. So, like, imagine if I started to write with a pencil, and the part of my brain that controls writing starts to work harder because it's controlling me writing. And by working harder, it uses more oxygen. So a functional MRI shows how much oxygen your brain is using and where. So they put you, like, in a functional MRI, and they would flash random pictures, and then every once in a while an equation will flash up, and they see what part of my brain starts to work when I do math and then compare it to control subjects. And they found that mine was almost predominantly, I believe, left hemisphere. But they've done it on all sorts of different things. And functional MRIs, I for sure, are going to change the way that we are able to study the brain because they can see what's going on inside the brain. I was just talking to somebody about a study about empathy where they had people in a functional MRI and they had somebody, the tester somehow had their hands in front where the person in the functional MRI could see the scientist's hands. But one of the scientist's hands was fake. It wasn't a real, I think they actually both were fake. But they looked real. And while the person was looking at them, the scientist person or the tester whipped out a hammer and smashed it on their own hand. It wasn't the person's hand, but on their own hand. But it wasn't really their hand.
Right.
But the person thought it was. And their pain center lit up as though their hand got smashed.
Mm-hmm.
And it basically was showing, you know, this empathy part of the brain, how you can feel somebody else's pain. And you literally, and the reason why you can feel somebody's pain is because you literally, in a certain sense, are feeling their pain. What these are going to do are going to be amazing.
Jason, maybe I think.
He's going to be the expert on this.
To put his story in context, I've been studying savant syndrome for many, many years, and these are people who have a disability and they have some incredible ability superimposed on that. I don't know if any of you remember Leslie Lemke, who is blind, cognitively disabled. And yet, as a musician, a masterful musician, never having had a music lesson in his whole life, being blind so he can't read music, and yet he's able to perform at that level. And that's savant syndrome. And then in the last 10 years or so, and most of the savants that I've known were that way from in childhood, but in the last 10 years, I've run into a number of savants like Jason, who are individuals who are grown, ordinary people, adults, and have a head injury or some other kind of incident, maybe a stroke, and all of a sudden they are mathematicians or musicians or artists where none of that existed before. It just explodes on the scene. And I think hearing Jason do all this erudite math stuff, recognizing that he didn't like math at all, it's evident that there's been a transformation following his concussion. And so the acquired savant are persons who have some incident such as that and then have either musical or mathematical or artistic abilities. I know of about 70 such people worldwide presently. It's very rare. But I have 70 cases now where this ability has emerged suddenly following some kind of an incident. To the extent that we understand what's happening, it appears that there is an injury to the left hemisphere of the brain. That's the one we use most of the time, logical, sequential thinking, and language, and it serves us very well. We're sort of a left brain society, and it serves us very well. But there is an injury to the left hemisphere. Then there is recruitment of some undamaged brain tissue elsewhere in the brain, usually the right hemisphere, although not always. There is then rewiring to that area, and then there is the release of the dormant potential, stored potential that was not accessible or knowledgeable to the person before. And that's the what I call the little Rain Man within each of us. The studies that we've done so far tend to show left hemisphere damage with right brain compensation, although there are exceptions to that. We just are not at the point yet with imaging, as remarkable as imaging is, and it is remarkable. MRIs and something called fiber tracking, which is even more sensitive, we still have a long way to go in order to get down to the neuron and the synapse level to really understand what's happening in this beautiful organ of ours called the brain, which is a magnificent complexity and one that we're trying to unravel, but we're going to have to get better tools to do that. So that is the thing that intrigues me about acquired Savant syndrome. It's first of all that it occurs in the way that I mentioned, but of special interest to me is that released potential. Savants tend to know things they never learned. I think Jason knows some things at the time that this began to surface that he had never learned. They just came to the surface. He began to see these images that of that kind of complexity, not recognizing what they were, drawing them without realizing what he was drawing, probably not even knowing what a fractal was.
I didn't until I was told by professors that I was drawing fractals, and they told me at the time, they said they were only done on computers. There is a way to draw them that I didn't know what they were until I was told.
So my interest is in that buried potential and the question of how does it get there? And how much of that do we each have that we're not having access to? And more importantly, how can we tap that without getting mugged and some other kind of incident? And so my work at the present time is trying to better understand that. How is it people can know things they never learned? Leslie Lemke knows music instinctually. He hasn't learned to play the piano. He knows how, and professional musicians will look at Leslie and say, he knows what I went to school my whole life for, and he simply knows that. And so I'm convinced that that we all have that kind of buried potential, maybe not at that level, and maybe not mathematical, that mathematical, high mathematical level, but we have these places of information, and I think they get there through something I call genetic memory. That is, we don't just inherit how tall we are or the color of our hair or the color of our eyes. We inherit knowledge. And there's a lot of people who somehow object to that. I don't know why. It's the nature and nurture argument. The nurture people say we start with a blank disc. We're born with this remarkable organ called the brain. We put on what we experience and what we learn, and what we are at any point in time is what we put onto this blank disc. And I'm saying the savants, especially the acquired savants, point to the fact that we don't start with a blank disc. The brain comes loaded, factory installed, I call it, software of a variety of kinds, mathematics, art, music being the most common. And that is transmitted genetically. And it's not hard to understand because DNA, a speck of DNA can hold, literally a speck of DNA can hold the whole congressional library the speck of DNA. And that's another whole story. But so there's a mechanism of transferring that amount of knowledge. So I'm interested in the issue of that very potential. And more recently, how can we tap that without having some kind of a central nervous system incident? And that's where we are at the present time. You may want to tell how our paths happened across.
Right. I remember when this whole event was happening, and I'm buried in my house, not hiding from reality, basically. And there was many times that I wondered, am I that crazy guy who thinks he sees math everywhere? Because you would see somebody talking to themselves on the road, and I would think, that guy doesn't know he's crazy. He doesn't know he's talking to somebody that's not there. What if I think I'm seeing math everywhere and I don't? Because I had never heard of anything like this. And then I was watching television, and I saw Dr. Treffert with Daniel Tammet. And Daniel Tammet was talking about what numbers looked like. And I remember it being this, literally I was fist pumping, jumping around the house when I realized that this was something that existed, and that me talking about what numbers looked like wasn't crazy, or at least if I was, there was one other person that was crazy with me. But as it turned out, it's not. But that's how our paths crossed, and in the long run, it did turn out to be an absolutely, the best thing ever. I wouldn't have my kids because I wouldn't have gone back to school. I wouldn't have written a book. And then I always forget to say this, but the book's rights were, anybody know who Channing Tatum is, the actor? Mm-hmm. He just bought the rights to my book, and he's going to be starring as me in the film. So, to get a chance, maybe Google it later and you can.
He's taking some math lessons now.
Yeah, and he's taking math lessons. So if you can take Channing Tatum, take lessons, math lessons, and you can make me interested in math, then I think we could get some more kids to stay in math long enough to be interested.
And he was going to spend some time with you too, I think.
Yeah, at some point, yeah, he's going to be coming out and staying with us, so he can learn to, act like me, basically. Which is going to be interesting. And he's going to have to lose a lot of weight. Or I'm going to have to pack on a lot of muscle. Sorry, go ahead.
Are you seeing things geometrically, Jason, when you're looking at us?
Always.
You are.
Yes, always. It's like a picture on top. But if you're not moving, like right now, you're not moving relative to me, so it's like a picture on a picture. But if you move sideways, then it's much more profound. Not moving, the curves are straight, like pixel-like, but it's just like a flip book that's not moving. It's just in the same position, so it's not nearly as profound.
Does that affect your equilibrium? Or?
I had weeks of vertigo. I mean, I had...
Yeah, but now yet or no?
No, every once in a while I still get little bouts of it. A little while ago I had a bout, but not nearly as extreme. Like where I would move and it would look like the world would go and shift, and it would also feel like it shifted, but then it would come back quickly. It wasn't constant like it was a long time ago. Go ahead first.
Thank you very much for sharing your story. I appreciate it. And I can say that I kind of understand what you're talking about. Not much, but it's provoked me to get interested in it. When you met the physicist and you learned about Dr. Treffert, did that happen at the same time?
I don't remember the timeline. That is one of those things that I'm really bad at now. Many times I'll be off. I've said things where I thought I did it at a certain time, and it turned out I did it 9 months or a year before. So I don't remember the exact timeline. I think when we first talked, it would have been close, probably, but at first we talked like on the internet or through email, and it wasn't in depth at first. It was not somewhat in depth, but not super in depth. So I don't remember. I really just don't remember.
Yeah, one of the things about the other acquired savants is they often had the same experience as Jason as they begin to think differently, or suddenly can play the piano where they didn't before. They're reluctant to tell their friends about it because they're going to say, well, you're, this is crazy, or you're getting crazy, or you are a great man, or whatever. And so one of the things that what I call a savant registry, I have 70 such cases now. The first contact is, in fact, I have an email I just got this afternoon from somebody who said that he really wanted to talk to me or make contact with me, because he said what he was experiencing felt like craziness, and he was afraid to tell his friends about it, even his family. And so when I write back and tell them that you're not alone, and that this is a phenomenon that you can be proud of instead of having to sort of submerge, it really is interesting. And with Savant, acquired savants or others, about the time I think I've heard it all, comes some new skill or some new ability, which is startling.
Do you ever get savants that develop one or more than one skill, like math and music?
Yes. It's usually the skill is typically is in one area, but we do have some savants who are skilled in several areas. There's a savant I met some years ago, Treffert was his name, and he was a musical savant, and he was about 8 or 10 years old, and just a prodigy, just a magnificent musician at age 8 or 9, and he got a lot of actually worldwide publicity at that time. He lives in Australia. And then he went on to get involved in chess and ended up being an international chess champion. And I lost track of Trevor then. And then a couple of years ago, I said, I wonder whatever happened to Trevor Thomas. So I wrote to his dad, who's a pediatrician, and he said Trevor had gone to UCLA and he got his PhD in mathematics, and he read the name of the thesis to me that I had no understanding of whatsoever. But so he was musical and mathematical as well as this chess champ. Now, he didn't lose his musical ability. He still has it, but since he wasn't using it as much, it's not as profound as it once was. And I think the relationship in many savants between music and math is very evident, and I think the relationship between music and math is a very close one.
Absolutely, and that was one of the things that I noticed was that it's difficult for your family to deal with it, because my family was used to me the way I was, and it was very hard for my parents to take it. I mean, they got so many calls, you know, at 2 o'clock in the morning. When I would, you know, do you know that there's no such thing as a circle, or do you know this, do you know that? And before, I wouldn't call them, because I would be out at bars and goofing off and chasing girls or doing whatever. And so, I mean, it can be annoying for family members, because I feel a need constantly to be talking about it. And it took me a long time to realize that while it's interesting to me, they don't want to hear about it all the time. Go ahead, back to the person. Then you after that.
Do you still sing, and do you play any other instruments, or did you ever when you were younger?
Yeah, I love singing. I've always been, you know, had a good, you know, I hate saying perfect pitch, but I do have that perfect pitch. And I can play the piano. I've always been able to play the piano. But I've never taken piano lessons, but I'm not fantastic at it. I mean, I could play like maybe Moonlight Sonata or Fürerlied, but I can play the whole Fürerlied, not just that beginning part. But still, it took me weeks to learn it, you know, to learn a song when I was a kid. And the way I learned it as a kid is I had a stepdad who I found out later he played in some sort of you know, professional type orchestra, and he took the notes on that were on the paper, you know, written for the music, and he actually drew them on a piece of tape and then taped the notes onto the keys of the piano, so you could look at the note and match it to the key on the piano and just learn to play that way. So my brother and I both learned how to play the piano, although I haven't played it in years, but we were just thinking about getting one though for the kids. Go ahead.
Do you teach, or is it it's like basically consulting
that you do? Yeah, I do a lot of lecturing. Like, I've done a couple TED Talks now, and I'm going to be speaking at something called WASWUG. It's a convention on Pi Day, March 14th. It's always Einstein's birthday. Yeah, Pi Day is like the one holiday that I really like now. Nobody else knows of. So I'm the only one celebrating, it seems like. But anyway, it's a teacher's convention where there's 1,000 teachers, and the title is Calculus for Kids, you know, concepts before equations, so that we can get these neat concepts that are fun to talk about, how my shirt's every color, and sounds every sound, and how pi works in a neat, fun way, so that when kids do hit math, they start seeing where it's coming from. Like when I hit calculus, it was so much more fun. I seemed like I was the only one in the class enjoying it. I remember one day my professor actually said, she goes, I am tired of only having a conversation with one person. And she told me, she said, Jason, this is nothing against you, but today you don't get to talk. I'm going to make other students respond. And I had to sit there and bite my tongue so that we could get somebody else to talk to the professor.
But have you developed any ways to inculcate that? I'm math illiterate, basically. That's not my forte, and I struggle with it, and always have. Just and your transformation was absolutely fascinating, but I'm interested, and I'm wondering if you develop things, or for these kids now coming down the pike. I'm on a slippery slope out, but the kids are coming.
That's what this whole talk is going to be about for them, is to show them how it works geometrically in a simple way, so that they'll be able to understand it without any equations. If they can multiply, they can understand pi. At a calculus 2 level.
Thank you.
Sorry.
I wanted you to just briefly talk about how you helped the lady who helped you write your book discover that she was okay, even though she saw colors that nobody else saw, and all these other people are saying, well, I have that too, but it's
yes.
Okay to handle that.
Yes, it's a synesthesia. Maureen Seberg is her name. She's a co-author. She's very, very nice lady and a great writer. She has synesthesia, and synesthesia is like a combining of the senses, so like numbers or colors. And it can be an advantage. So like if you think about you're just writing on a paper and you've got a bunch of numbers, if the number 4 is always purple and the number 6 is always green, then when the wrong color stands out on the page, it can make mistakes leap out at you. So that was one of the things that was good for her, is to also learn that this was something, there was different forms of our synesthesia or Savant syndrome, because it is hard to tell people about it. If you don't think it's normal, and you tell somebody, I smell the color blue, they're like, what are you talking about? Most of them. So most of the time people don't talk about it.
This is from Dr. Treffert. Do these Savant instances that occur after a head trauma occur because that trauma involved a certain part of the brain? I mean, there are many people who have had concussions and don't become savant. I've had 3 of them.
Right.
So,
good question. In terms of if this is true, how come with all the head injuries and strokes, we don't see more of these cases? Well, Dr. Bruce Miller, who's a neurologist in San Francisco and a friend of mine, was dealing with patients with frontotemporal dementia. Frontotemporal dementia is somewhat different than Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's is a generalized process. Frontotemporal dementia picks certain areas of the brain. In fact, it's called Pick's disease after a Dr. Pick, but it's germane because it picks certain. What he found was that he found 12 patients who had frontotemporal dementia who developed some unusual art or musical skills, and some of them are at a prodigious level. And so he did what was called SPECT imaging, which is a form of imaging. And he found that in all of these individuals, the lesion was in the left anterior temporal area. And so then he did a SPECT imaging on a young savant artist. And lo and behold, the lesion or the deficiency was in the left anterior temporal area. So I think the reason that you don't see as many acquired savants as one might think is, first of all, it depends where the head injury is. And secondly, it depends on to what extent does that person have that dormant potential. It's the usual bell-shaped curve. Most of us fall in that medium range, but there are people out there like Jason in mathematics who are on that end of the bell-shaped curve. So the reason, it depends on which area of the brain is affected, and it depends also on to what extent does that person have that that varied potential. But it's interesting that in congenital savants, it's about 5 to 1 men to women, and there are reasons for that. But I speculated when I looked at my 70 acquired savants that that the relationship between the sexes would be equal, but it's not. It still is a male predominant thing. I think, however, it may be that males are more prominent to head injury than women, and but that should not be the case in stroke. So I think we're going to see a closer relationship between the sexes. But as I said, the answer to your question depends. For example, 1 out of 10 autistic individuals has some savant abilities. 1 out of 1,400 people with head injuries has savant abilities. So there's a special relationship between autism and savant syndrome. And 75% of my congenital savants are autistic. And one will say, well, why is that? Well, earlier work and even more recent work shows that autistic individuals, children with autism, tend to have a left hemisphere dysfunction. There are reasons for that. Well, let me say what the reasons are. All of us in utero, in the womb, developing, the left hemisphere completes its development later than the right hemisphere. That's just through the whole animal and human kingdom, which means that the left hemisphere is at risk for a longer period of time than the right hemisphere to anything that might be detrimental to it. Testosterone can be damaging to neuronal tissue. And in the autistic fetus, at the time when he is developing his secondary sexual characteristics, the level of testosterone is as high as it is in an adult male. So you have a more vulnerable left hemisphere being exposed to testosterone in the male, which leaves that gap. The same in terms of language disorders, stuttering, and other disorders tend to be male-dominated, again, affecting the left hemisphere. And there's good evidence from way back that autistic individuals have a left hemisphere dysfunction, which accounts for that discrepancy. I hope that doesn't confuse you.
Of course. Yeah.
Jason, you mentioned your memory. Has any domain of your memory changed after that incident?
Yeah, I've noticed that I don't recall names very well at all. Used to not be a problem. Sometimes I search for words where I didn't ever notice that I was searched for words before sometimes. And time. It's weird when I try to remember an event. Like sometimes I'll be way off, but when I'm trying to remember the time, like if I wake up in the middle of the night, I almost always know within a couple minutes what time it is, even though I've been sleeping. So that's something that I did notice that changed. Like if I wake up, I'm like, it should be 3:52, and it's always in a couple minutes
in
that.
I think one thing about Jason's case is that I'm looking more and more for cases where there is no what I call trade-off. In other words, some of the acquired savants who have a head injury or a stroke, there is a trade-off. They lose cognitive function or they lose memory or they have some other residual. Might even be a physical residual. But I'm finding more and more cases now where there is no trade-off. Now, to my at least relative relatively speaking, I don't think there is any trade-off. He's able to function admirably, in addition to being a very pleasant fellow to spend time with, is able to talk to an audience like this and say what happened. So I'm looking for those cases where there is no trade-off, and I'm finding more. There's a orthopedic surgeon in New York who was struck by lightning and survived. And he basically was a man of the 60s. He was a rocker, and suddenly developed an interest in classical music. And he had to listen to the classical music hour after hour after hour, and it simply became obsessed with it. Finally, he said, I don't want to just listen to it. I want to learn how to play. And he learned how to play very quickly. And soon wrote a song. It's called the Lightning Sonata, which is a very complicated piece. But he is performing surgery, and he's performing concerts at the, the same point. So he essentially has not had a trade-off. And that, I think, is... I'm finding a few more cases like that, but certainly Jason fits into that category as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, there's two than you.
During that 3 years that you were in seclusion, sort of,
right?
I mean, did you tell your family? Did your friends come and see you?
I talked to my family a little bit, but that I didn't. I pretty much cut off, not purposely, but I just disappeared, off the face of the earth. I remember seeing people in Alaska that knew me, and they didn't recognize me because I used to. Back in my wild days, I actually won Mr. Alaska. I was big, I had big muscles, I had that long, horrible mullet. I looked like the wedding singer, literally. And when people in Alaska saw me, there was rumors that I was dying of a cancer and all sorts of things because I looked so different, and nobody knew what had happened. I did talk to my parents, but I think I'm... At first scared my mom, then she got used to it. My dad, it just annoys him, because he is just not interested.
Did you go online or something and say, Google, I am doing this?
I didn't talk to people online but I did, search for things online,
You were feeling the way you were feeling.
Or I would, more often than not, I would look up, things about black holes or space time, that type of thing. I spent a lot of time, looking at that type of thing.
How old were you when you had the injury?
32. So now I'll be 46 in 5 days.
Happy birthday.
Go ahead. In relation to that question, do you think that the prevalence is more? Because there's certainly probably a lot of people who have something happen to them and they never get out of their house again for the rest of their lives, and it may be shorter because of that. Do you think that the prevalence is much more or just somewhat more?
I think there might be some people out there, because for sure, if nothing would have happened, I could easily still be there, hold up in the house if I hadn't seen that show and started that change in life, which made everything change. But I could easily see it have gone in the other way, and just spiral down into negative.
I think there are people out there that we don't know about. And the reason we don't know about them is because they don't want to come out, so to speak. And I think there's been a lot of information recently on the acquired savant, some of it because of the work that I've been doing, which is literally on the internet. And I think some of these people will Google maybe savant syndrome, and they discover that there are cases. They'll write to me and find out that it's okay. And they will, come forth. So I think that the awareness of the acquired savant syndrome, I think, has brought more cases to attention. And the same is true of savant syndrome. I think before the movie Rain Man, savant syndrome was not even mentioned very often. But the movie Rain Man brought forth, it made autistic savant sort of household terms. And with that, parents would begin to write or to inquire. And I think years ago in the institutions, including Winnebago, I think there were a lot of savants probably that were never discovered. Occasionally, you read an institutional case where somebody, some aide or somebody on the internet discovered that ability musical ability of that particular patient, and they became sort of a celebrity on the unit. So I think we're there are more out there than, and we're more comfortable talking about it now.
Okay, go ahead, sorry.
I've been reading your book, and it's just fascinating, hard to put down. But I'm curious about, you talked about the water, the dripping and the light, the colors and the forms. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about that a minute?
Yes, water is by far, that and light hitting water builds a grid. I mean, it's absolutely beautiful. Instead of having this smoothness that it used to have, it looks like little tangents swirling as it goes down the drain, and it's literally like a recursive form of the Pythagorean theorem, which is like, say, you know, a squared plus b squared equals c squared, you know, when we're talking about a right triangle. And a recursive form of that is basically saying a squared plus b squared equals c squared, but we can now draw another triangle that this hypotenuse becomes a leg on the next one. So basically you get the answer, you say a squared plus b squared equals c, we take c and we put it back in as a, and say sure. b always equals 1, and then you get a new answer, put it back as a,
got that.
And it makes a spiral. It's
you didn't know that before?
No, I didn't.
Whenever you see water,
you
can see those
points. Yes, and light on water is just, or watching two boats that each have made a wake and the wake overlapped each other. You can, if you put my drawing of pi next to it, you'll see the way that the waves overlap is identical to the drawing. Yes, or go ahead and then I'll do the answer. Sorry.
My question is not nearly as technical. What I just want to know is, could your abilities be transmitted genetically to your children?
I think so, because we are all, I mean, like I said, when you see me moving, we're doing serious math, you know, it's just you're doing it in this natural way, and we're all, I have a 2.5-month-old now, and I was moving my finger, and she started tracking my finger, and I'm like, she's tracking me, and that's still math, you know, that's relative motion compared to her, and I'll sit there and watch her little finger move, or watch her eyes move as she watches my finger, and it amazes me, and they're born with that. So, and her heart's beating, so her body is controlling all these processes that's all mathematical, you know, without question. It's just that we're born with a certain amount of it, how much I don't know, but it's got to be quite a bit.
I think the answer is yes.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
We find, for example.
Go ahead. Yeah. No, sorry.
If you were to like describe the universe in geometric terms on at least like a semi-basic level, how would you go about that? I mean, you can do that vaguely or specifically, but I'm just curious how you would approach that.
It's real quick, but we could just do a grid structure, basically. I mean, I'll just do a real basic grid, but I didn't realize it's open. I should have been open. It's a grid. And a piece of graph paper, you know, is a little grid like this. Not done a very good job here. So the universe, you know, when we graph in algebra, you know, we'll be graphing an equation, you know, relative to a grid like this, you know, and make a line.
Right.
The space-time, if you picture this as being the whole universe, it's a grid structure. And just say, and for instance, instead of graphing a dot, here's me as I move through space-time from that grid to this grid to this grid, you know, it's literally the same thing. Space-time is a three-dimensional grid structure, or I should say, space is three-dimensional, time is the fourth dimension. So, for instance, like if you graph an equation and make one shape, and you graph another equation and it crosses that graph, where the two equations meet, that's where the equations are equal. But in space-time, so you would say here they're equal, but in space-time, I could go through this point, and then 2 seconds later, you could go through this point so that they're not equal. So in space-time, in order for two things to be equal, you have to meet in that space at the same time. So basically, I would say always think of it as this three-dimensional grid structure, and think of numbers this way. Like, if you think of the number, like I would always wonder, like, how does the universe see the number four? You know, and think of it as just being, you know, a grid like this, which is that's the number four. There's just four squares. That's the number four, and then four squared is that four squared into 16. And so we're literally just squaring that 4. And then 4 cubed is that is 4 squared and cubed geometrically into 64. So when you're thinking about, you know, square roots and things like that, it always has to do with this grid structure, space-time. And we're traveling through it at all times. And so they call translating an equation. Like if you have the equation x squared, which makes that little parabola like that, you can now say x squared plus 1 makes this exact same shape go up 1. X squared plus 2 goes up here. But if you see those in sequence, like first in one picture frame, you see x squared. The next picture frame, you see x squared plus 1. The next picture frame, you see x squared plus 2. What that looks like is this U shape moving upward. And so I am translating through space-time just like we translate equations. In other words, I'm moving around the sun, even though it doesn't seem like I'm moving. You know, we're revolving at 900 miles an hour. We're going around the sun, I think at like 18 or 19 miles per second. And then all of us move a million miles every single day. It's just that relative to each other, we're moving with each other, so it doesn't seem like it, but we are flying, you know, and we're flying relative to this grid structure of space-time. In fact, what's even weirder is that everything, all of us and every molecule, every atom, everything in the universe is moving through space-time exactly at the speed of light, always. And that's one of those weird things, is it's hard to imagine, but literally we are always moving through space-time at the speed of light. Yeah, go ahead and move.
A couple years ago, there was a program on explaining a lot of this stuff, and after about 3 minutes, I had a headache that was just pounding. But I think because you see things from both sides of the story, I'm pretending now that I can understand what you're talking about. But my head doesn't hurt. But I think this, you know, is going to do you wonders with, like you say, with the younger people, because you see it from both sides. And you don't know which side that kid's seeing it from, so you can explain it to him both ways. And
most of us see things geometrically. Most of us aren't equation people. Equations is just, it's a language. You've got to be good at languages, or specifically equations, to understand it. Whereas all of us see things, you know, most of us see things geometrically, so it's easier to understand that way. And most of us don't need to prove things rigorously like they do, you know, scientifically, when they really have to get down and get every single thing perfect. But most of us don't need this. Most of us just want to understand the basic idea. So, okay, go ahead, and then you added that, sorry. Yeah.
Oh, I just wanted to say, I mean, I'll listen to you forever, because I was just telling this gentleman about my bucket list is to try and get my head around, like, relativity and quantum mechanics, you know. I haven't quite gotten it yet, but I'll keep listening until...
Quantum mechanics is one of those things that none of us ever get it fully, because it is so strange, and it is so counterintuitive.
But yet so much of our technology, or a lot of our technology is based
on it. In fact, quantum computers are on their way here. And like we and I, we were just talking about, my shirt is really every color. In quantum mechanics, you can be in more than one place at the same time. You can be in an infinite number of positions at the same time, and it's okay, because it really, that's how it works. And what's even weirder is in quantum mechanics, everything runs on probability. It's been, if you've ever read The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, when they have the infinite improbability drive, they're literally making fun of quantum mechanics, because I remember reading about, like, Einstein talking about this and saying how strange he thought it was, that everything has a certain probability of occurring. And that probability, like, say, that we're going to locate something in a certain position, creates what's called a probability wave. So picture a ripple of water running through space-time, but it's really just a probability. And then there's another probability that something else could happen. And then all these other probabilities of all these things that could happen, and all these probability waves overlap each other. And you know how when waves hit each other, they make a new wave? that new wave that all the probabilities make as they take the sum of the histories is what actually happens in reality.
That's what we're talking about, our election.
Yeah, there you go. Yes, all these strange probabilities. But what's so weird is that if you have all these probable things that could happen that then create the wave that describes what does happen, what it means is that what actually happens in reality is dependent on what doesn't happen. But if something doesn't happen, how does it affect what does? And nobody really gets it, but somehow...
Two particles, they can be in the far-flung universe, but yet...
Yes, that's called quantum entanglement.
Yeah.
And so basically it means that, like we say, nothing can move faster than the speed of light. But we now know that you can quantumly entangle two particles. Basically, imagine you have one particle that's spinning, and you have this other one that is spinning identically to that particle. And then you could take these particles and you could put one on Jupiter and, you know, one here on Earth. So it means it would take, you know, hours at the speed of light, you know, to communicate with one on Jupiter. If you observe this one, you can tell the spin of the other one instantaneously by what the other one does, even though it's faster than the speed of light. And again, that's one of those things, nobody truly understands it, but... Because there is a faster-than-light something occurring, but nobody truly knows how to describe it. But there is definitely nothing that has mass that's moving faster than the speed of light. But there is some... The best explanation I've heard is by Brian Greene, who says there's a faster-than-light something going on, but we don't know what it is. And that's quantum entanglement or non-locality. So... It's very strange.
Wasn't Sheldrake the one that first came up with that?
I think his name was Bell. I thought it was called Bell's Theorem. Bell's Theorem.
Yeah, but Sheldrake did a lot with it, too.
Oh, I'm sure, yeah. There's definitely been a lot of people that have been involved with it.
He talked about how you can have a particle over here and a twin over here, and when that changes, this one changes.
Yes.
Even though they're ends apart.
Yes, and they can be close together, they can be far apart, but it's instantaneous.
Right.
Yes, and it's one of those amazing things that nobody really truly understands. If you ever have a chance to look this other one up, the one thing that I would tell everybody to look up is the double slit test.
What is it?
It's called the double slit test. It's how light behaves as a wave and a particle, depending on whether it's being observed.
Right.
And it's wild. It's wild. it gets into parallel universes and stuff because nobody can really... There's a bunch of competing theories. You know, it's basically that everything acts like a wave. So, like, imagine we have, like, there's a wall here. Like, we have a wall, right? You know, say this is metal, right? We have two little slits right here that are just empty. And you can fire electrons through either the left slit or the right slit. And what happens is you wind up getting this interference pattern as though two waves are overlapping and interfering with each other, even when they shoot one electron through at a time. So in other words, what it appears is that the electron actually somehow goes through both slits, creates ripples that interfere with itself. And there's people that have different ideas as to what causes that. And the one that I kind of think is real is what I'm calling the mini worlds theory, is that it actually does go through both slits and both realities happen. And if that's the case, then there's an infinite number of realities constantly splitting off, you know, every Planck time. But it's one of those things that's totally up for debate. But if you get a chance, look up the double slit test. It'll give you years of thought. I'm wondering.
Your question about the mirror effect, you know, way distant. The reason that I've gotten some interest in quantum mechanics and theory is because of telepathy, which I think telepathy exists. And I've got several cases where that, even though I was skeptical and am skeptical, working with these particular individuals, I'm convinced that the telepathy is real. And I've been corresponding with some other people about, you know, how is that possible? And that gets into the kind of thing that you're mentioning, the quantum mechanics thing. But I have no idea
Doctor, what about precognition, where you know an event is going to happen before it happens, and it happens exactly the way you either dreamed it or envisioned it?
Yeah, well, that's, as I said, that's an area I ordinarily would not have ventured into at all. But I'm sort of, insatiably curious. And as I meet these people, and as I'm convinced that this is a real phenomenon, as I am today, at least in three or four cases, you know, what's the possible explanation other than some nearly far out things? I think there may be something to that.
Yeah, I mean, this thing with the quantumly entangled particles, they're saying even might help us study what's in the black hole. So if you can quantumly entangle two particles and send one into a black hole, then it's possible, perhaps, that you can see what's going on with the quantum entangled particle that's out here. You can see what the other one's doing when it goes inside. But that's all just theory.
Isn't the theory with the black holes that new universes explode out of them?
Yeah, in fact, the Big Bang sounds like the exact reverse of a black hole.
Right.
In fact, there's somebody that came up with something called a Planck star. Remember I was telling you, like, empty space vibrates? Well, and the smaller you get, the more it vibrates because of uncertainty. So imagine we have a black hole that's collapsing into a smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller point. And we say, okay, it just keeps collapsing forever. There are some physicists that have come out with a theory that said, well, you do eventually get so small that the quantum fluctuations become so extreme that it causes it to blow up, which
right.
sounds like the Big
Bang. The Big Bang.
Which is,
yeah.
you know, everything coming
universe.
From a tiny
yeah.
little point. So,
yeah.
yeah, that would mean that there would very likely be an infinite number of Big Bangs. And I have a hard time believing this is the only Big Bang.
Right.
There was nothing for eternity, there's a Big Bang, and there'll be nothing after this
right.
for eternity. I think there's an infinite number of Big Bangs.
Okay. Yeah. I have a question, Dr. Treffert, if I might ask. You mentioned you know of 70 savants. What is a geographical spread, if you know, like Western civilization or Eastern? And what are their fields? In other words, Jason is math, and Lemke is music.
Right. The 70 are distributed probably about 60% or so are from the English-speaking nations. And part of that is because of the internet, and my site is in English, and so you know I get things from Hungary and all other, and I can't read them obviously. So it is a worldwide distribution, although it's skewed toward the English-speaking nations. And the most common ability is music. The second is art, and the third is math. And that is pretty much the same distribution as in congenital savants.
How many congenital savants have you kept track of over or worked with over the years?
Well, I think we're somewhere in that. I've sort of been a little, I've gotten so involved with the acquired savants that I've sort of been neglecting putting my new savants into the congenital. But we're talking about probably 350 or 400. Congenital, so, but that is, there are a lot out there that I don't know about.
We always hear about the aging brain, which annoys the crap out of me. how does the aging brain affect the ability of the savant? Does it cause it to diminish with time or lose its sharpness?
No, the savants that I Leslie is in his 60s now, and he's playing. He's doing more composing than he ever did. He did a piece recently at a concert where he took his How Great Thou Art as his favorite hymn and enmeshed that with Beethoven's Fifth Symphony in the same piece, which was simply a marvelous transition. So, and George Finn and his brother, who were calendar calculators, they lived into their 60s. So there doesn't seem to be, there's no decrease in age. Longevity, and so long as they are alive, they have that ability. They don't lose that ability. The aging brain, though, is an interesting question. That I mentioned the dementia patients who have dementia, and they lose their capacity, and in this few people, these new abilities emerge. And I got an email from a gentleman who said, we are all aging, and we are all losing some capacity. When you mentioned forgetting names, or I thought, oh my God, I do the same thing. And his point was that as we age, we're probably losing some cortical capacity, and that allows things to emerge that otherwise wouldn't have emerged, just like it did with the dementia patients. So that you read about Grandma Moses or other people getting an interest later in life, I've experienced, I think, some of that same thing in terms of areas that I wasn't interested in before. So that it may be that as the brain ages, normally ages, not abnormally with dementia, that we're uncovering some of that capacity within ourselves, and those things that sort of emerge when we're retired, when we think it's because we have more time, but it really has been an uncovering process that's emerging, I'm inclined to believe that's probably so.
I wondered, when you were sort of hibernating for 3 years, mm-hmm. how did you support yourself?
Luckily, this house that we had, it was my dad's house, and it was paid off. I had some money, but my family, my dad helped out a lot. He owned some furniture factories, and he did really well in Alaska. And I also had a little futon store in Alaska prior to that. So it was tight, but with no bills, basically all I had to do was come up with child support and food, and that was it. So it was tight, but it was very inexpensive.
During that 3-year period, was there ever any contact from doctors or anybody that they told you or said, we can help you? Or
that was one of the bad things about this whole thing is that at the time, if you had a pre-existing condition, you couldn't get insurance. And since I got attacked by these guys and my neck was all messed up, I couldn't get any insurance. I couldn't go to the hospital. In fact, when I went to the hospital, I had a huge bill that I wasn't able to pay. Because of that, and so at the time I wasn't able to get health insurance for years, so I didn't go to that. Eventually, I went to Finland to get the functional MRIs done because it was free there. So, yeah, I didn't go to the doctors. I went to like a psychologist eventually, but I avoided them just because of the expense. And now I've got insurance, so that's changed.
I'm wondering about your average person who doesn't have Jason's ability, but yet sometimes an answer will just pop into your head and you don't know where it came from, but it's the right answer. So does this sometimes, is it able to sift through everything else or is it just luck? But it's the right answer, you know what I mean?
Yeah, well, I think all of us at times have intuitive flashes, or we're thinking, or we've solved a problem, or some kind of a thought comes to us that is not our usual kind of thinking, and intuitive, and may in fact be a sort of an aha moment, and they have a way, I think, of, I think it's the same process. It's just, why is that as random as it is? Wouldn't it be nice if we could harness that kind of moment or experience? But I think it is the same process. But the whole idea of creativity and the aha kind of experience and problem solving and isolated genius, in order for us to understand that, we're going to have to get much more sophisticated in our imaging than we presently do. I mean, the MRI and CAT scans and functional imaging is wonderful. It makes really nice pictures. But we're not at the level that the aha moment exists to where we could actually measure that or see that coming. So I think hopefully we will, we'll get there. But that moment, the aha moment, actually, to the extent that you've been able to measure the aha moment, and there are some tests that you can give people to solve problems. And they, if you do an imaging study during that time, you find out that that spot is in the right hemisphere rather than the left hemisphere. And the whole, one of the problems with imaging also is that it's hard to play the piano in an MRI machine. until we develop, and there is a development, there's something called the PET helmet, which just came out within the last 6 months, where you can do an imaging study with PET scanning, and the person wears a helmet, and they actually can be exercising and moving. So if we want to understand the difference between a professional musician and a savant, and we want to measure that, we're going to have to measure that when they're playing the piano, not when they're thinking about playing the piano or imagining you're playing the piano. So I think that some of that intuitive or the kinds of things that we all experience. And I think, well, what Jason describes seems rather distant at times in terms of the way it happened and the way it came about. I think it's much closer to our functioning than we think it is.
My question is for Dr. Treffert. Do you think genetic counseling, which is a whole other field, but do you think that will give any assistance into some of the information that you're trying to get?
Yeah, absolutely. I think we're doing, of course, all of medicine is going to be revolutionized by genetic counseling, to where one day, as a psychiatrist, if I'm to choose an antidepressant for a patient of mine, instead of going on my past experience or what I think helped or what helped other people, I'll be able to get a blueprint, a genetic blueprint of that person, which says this is that medication for that patient. We do that already in breast cancer in terms of finding out which approach is best for certain patients with breast cancer. And instead of saying, well, let's try this, and then we'll try that, and then we'll try this one, and then we'll try that one. So that kind of personalized medicine for hypertension, diabetes, and other things, I think eventually, and we're getting there. In autism, I have a friend who works at the Cleveland Clinic who's doing a lot of genetic research, and what we're going to find is that autism is not a single disorder. It is a group of disorders, just like mental retardation is not a single disorder. There are probably 100 reasons why somebody can end up with mental retardation. I still use that term, even though it's not supposed to be used. But there's lead poisoning, and there's Down syndrome. The final common path, we call that person cognitively disabled. I think with autism, it's the same thing. We're going to find out that autism is a group of disorders with the final common path. But I think I look forward. I probably won't be around long enough to realize.
Yes, you will.
The results of that. But I look forward to the time when I'll be able to design designer medicine for all sorts of, and it is going to be based on genetic counseling. So.
Do you still have a quest to learn? You mentioned quantum physics and all that. Do you still have a drive that you want to learn more about this math?
Yeah, I always do. And I think I know for a fact I always will. Without question, yeah.
Well, thank you so much.